So I would like to move forward and invite Dr. Srinivas Reddy. He is the consultant neonatologist at Giggles for Omnia RK Women and Children Hospital, Visakhapatnam, Andhra Pradesh. So I would like you to take over.
Thank you, madam. Thank you for the introduction. Am I audible and clear?
Yes, sir, you are audible. Yeah. Thank you so much.
So myself, I am Dr. Srinivas Reddy, a consultant neonatologist from Visakhapatnam. So this program, NNF and UNICEF collaborated program, is a very good program. Especially we are starting this module for the first topic, that is approach to respiratory distress. So we'll try to keep it simple to all the doctors of the SNCUs and nurses and all the staff. We'll try to teach whatever the basic that is most important. So based upon the resources, so most of the SNCUs, we will be having a CPAP, and ventilators we will cover a little less, more we'll concentrate on the CPAP part and all the respiratory distress problem. So without much wasting, we'll start our presentation today.
Yes, sir.
Are my slides visible, madam?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
No, it is not now.
No, madam, it is visible now.
Yes, sir.
So starting on the basic topic, that is approach to respiratory distress in newborn. So the learning objectives of this presentation, especially this part of learning objective, is we'd like to define what is respiratory distress. So when do you call there is a respiratory distress in newborn? So what about the cause? If you know the cause only, we know how to treat the baby. So and how to reach the diagnosis. So once the approach to diagnosis is most important, you will see how we are going to diagnose based upon the distress, based upon various factors. We'll try how simply we can diagnose the distress. And assessment of severity. So we need to, based upon the severity, we need to titrate the support. Some babies may require oxygen. Some babies may require CPAP support. Some babies may require ventilator support. So we'll decide based upon different severity scores, how we'll decide the support, that we will decide, and principles of the management. So once we have known the cause, once we have known the severity, so how are we going to approach? This will be the normal agenda of this presentation. So coming to the definition of respiratory distress in newborn, see, respiratory distress and respiratory distress syndrome are different. So respiratory distress means the baby is having some respiratory difficulty, which may be because of many causes. So because of respiratory distress syndrome. So previously hyaline membrane disease was called as RDS type 1. So don't confuse between respiratory distress and respiratory distress syndrome. So forget about the respiratory distress syndrome. Now we are talking about respiratory distress. That means the baby has some breathing difficulty. So who has defined this definition is National Neonatal and Perinatal Database has defined this definition. So what are the clinical features? So if you see a baby on the bedside, so when do you call the baby is having some respiratory difficulty? So based upon 3 to 4 parameters. So what are the parameters is respiratory rate. Whenever the baby has respiratory distress, the first and foremost, we'll see what was the respiratory rate. So is it a normal respiratory rate? Is it a higher or is it a lower? So we'll call respiratory distress whenever the respiratory rate is more than above the normal range. So what was the normal range in newborn's respiratory rate? So it is 40 to 60 breaths per minute. Suppose if the baby is taking more than 60 respiratory breaths per minute, or respiratory rate is more than 60 per minute, we call it as tachypnea. That means fast breathing. So that is one of the important factor of respiratory distress we need to identify. The second thing we need to identify is, so you can see in your sense use, most of the babies with respiratory distress have chest indrawing. So we call it as retractions or resistance. That means with normal inspiration, the baby's chest should go forward. But what happens in chest retractions is the baby's chest will be going deeper. That means there will be, the chest will be going deeper and you can see retractions. So all the retractions, recessions, all the name word is same. So you can see different retractions in different parts. You can see in the suprasternal areas, you can see in the subcostal areas, you can see in the intercostal areas. Wherever there is retractions, that indicate the baby is using accessory muscles for the breathing. That means the baby's breathing is not comfortable. The baby is taking the help of additional muscles that are called as accessory muscles for breathing. So that means the baby is having some problem. And the third important component of respiratory distress is grunting. So you, most of you come across, when all the baby, newborn baby is having distress, the baby will try to make some sound, like a moaning sound. So it will do some sounds, that is called as an expiratory grunt. So what is this grunt is, sick babies with a respiratory distress usually do one sound because they used to maintain PEEP. So what is PEEP is positive end expiratory pressure. Because of that, the babies will try to breathe against the closed glottis. That means the glottis will be normally open while breathing. Usually they will be partially closed so that some pressure will be maintained. So that is why you will see the grunt. So grunt, see these retractions and grunt, although seen in the respiratory distress, they are compensatory mechanisms. That means the baby is trying to use the additional muscles so that you are getting respiratory retractions. And the baby is trying to close the glottis so that pressure is maintained so that alveoli will not collapse. So this you will see expiratory grunt. That means the baby compensatory mechanisms, you see all these features. Suppose if the baby has any two features out of these three, that means a baby having a respiratory rate more than 60 with a chest indrawing, you call it as respiratory distress. Suppose if the baby is having a respiratory distress, a respiratory rate more than 60, and you can see an audible grunt without any retraction, then also you'll call it as a respiratory distress, because any of the two which satisfy the criteria out of the three, we can call it as a baby is having a respiratory distress. So there are many additional features, like there will be nasal flaring. That means the nostrils will be dilated while taking breathing, or when there can be decreased air entry, or there can be cyanosis. The other important factor is cyanosis. Cyanosis means bluish discoloration of the baby. So if at all are present in addition to the respiratory distress, that indicates the baby is having a more respiratory distress compared to the normal respiratory distress. So I hope I am clear that out of the three things, if any of the two is present, that indicates it's a respiratory distress. That is how we identify. So to make it more clear, we'll see in the videos how to identify respiratory distress at the latter part of the presentation. So once you define, suppose if the baby is having a grunting and respiratory rate more than 60, we define the baby is having a respiratory distress. So what next? So what could be the cause? How to identify the cause of the respiratory distress? Do all babies will have the same cause? No. All babies doesn't have no single cause, because some all fevers will not have same diagnosis. Some fevers will have a malaria, some fevers might have a dengue fever, some will be having a strep typhus, like that. The fever etiology varies like that. The respiratory distress is not a disease, it's a symptom. So we need to find out what was the underlying cause. The causes will depend upon the gestational age, because the premature babies, that is babies born less than 37 weeks, will have separate problems. And babies born more than 37 weeks, that is a term babies, will have separate issues. And based upon the age of onset, suppose the baby developing respiratory distress, which is most commonly you see in a delivery room, that have a separate diagnosis, like a meconium aspiration syndrome or a hyaline membrane diseases. Whereas a discharged baby at a day 10 or day 11 developing high grade fever, developing respiratory distress, this could be because of infection and pneumonias. So based upon onset, age of onset, when was actually the respiratory distress started, your diagnosis may be, or your cause may be different. So it helps in underlying clues for your diagnosis and based upon the underlying causes. So you'll see one by one, what are those? So based on the first thing is based on the gestational age. Suppose a preterm baby coming with a respiratory distress, what was your diagnosis? Most of the diagnosis will be RDS. I told previously it is called as HMD, that is hyaline membrane disease. So because it's a pathological diagnosis, that means the hyaline membranes are formed in the lungs, which are seen once we open the lungs, that is in the postmortem, they used to see these hyaline membranes and have coined those term. So now more appropriately, that HMD is called as type 1 RDS. So it is the most common cause. For now, I'm calling it as type 1 RDS with HMD to understand without any confusion. So the most commonest cause being RDS or the HMD will be the first most common. And the remaining causes will be pneumothorax, pneumonias, pulmonary hemorrhages, aspiration pneumonias, pleural effusion, or BPD or CLD are almost the same diagnosis. So whenever you see a premature baby less than 37 weeks, we call it a premature baby. Any baby less than 34 weeks, especially less than 34 weeks, presents with respiratory distress since birth, that means after their stabilization after delivery, or within 6 hours of delivery, unless otherwise proved, your diagnosis should be an HMD, that is a type 1 RDS. So remaining comes after. That means you need to exclude HMD. But that common is HMD, because HMD is that much common. So most of the diagnosis in a preterm baby is less than 37 weeks, especially will be the HMD diagnosis. And from the near term, that means near term babies are now called as a late preterm babies, that is between 34 to 36 weeks, which comes under preterm category only, but close to term babies. So that the most common diagnosis will be TTNB. This is because of TTNB is transient tachypnea of newborn. That means the babies, most of you heard about the amniotic fluid. So in the in utero life, the baby's lungs are flooded with amniotic fluid. And after birth with the first breath, this fluid should be cleared. So if there is a delayed clearance of fluid, then we'll call it as a transient tachypnea of newborn. And this usually settles by 48 to 72 hours. And the second most important diagnosis is meconium aspiration syndrome. So most of the time the baby will be passing of fetal motion inside the amniotic fluid, and the babies might swallow this motion, which is called as a meconium in babies, and it gets to the lungs, and these lungs gets affected, and it develops into meconium aspiration syndrome. So the other rare diagnosis or less common diagnosis are the pneumonias, PPHN, that's a persistent primary hypertension, that's pulmonary hypertension, aspiration pneumonias. Most of the day, times third day, fourth day babies while taking a bottle feeds or spoon feeds suddenly developing respiratory distress, and the grandmothers used to give in a lying down position, the baby gets cough and they develop say pneumonia because the milk will go into the lungs. That's the aspiration pneumonias. Effusion, that is a collection of fluid in the pleural spaces. Pulmonary hemorrhages, surfactant deficiencies, and very rare other diagnosis. So for this, based on the gestation, so if any baby with a preterm babies, unless otherwise proved, so its a diagnosis will be hyaline membrane disease. Very rarely the remaining diagnosis. For a term babies, the most common diagnosis will be the meconium aspiration syndromes, transient tachypnea of the newborn, that is delayed clearance of fluid, and pneumonias. These are the most common diagnosis, first possible diagnosis. Very rarely you will get a second diagnosis. So based upon the age of onset, so most of the babies, if you see after delivery, most of the babies will develop respiratory distress within 6 hours of life. So if the baby develops within 6 hours of life, whatever the distress that comes is most often because of the process of the deliveries or because of the problem with the babies. So your HMD, that is hyaline membrane disease, is because of surfactant deficiency. That means immaturity of the lungs. So the distress starts at birth. So within 6 hours. So meconium aspiration syndrome, usually meconium will be swallowed at the time of delivery or just before the delivery. So within 6 hours of the life, you will get respiratory distress. And any transient tachypnea of newborn, most of them will be within 6 hours of life because the fluid will be delayed clearance. The name itself is delayed clearance of the amniotic fluid. So it should start usually within the 6 hours of life. And these are all the common causes. Rare causes will be pneumothorax and other causes will be limited. And after 6 hours, mostly heart problems. So usually the babies will be deteriorating after day two or day three. Babies will be delivering, there will be no any problem. But suddenly on the day two or day three, the baby become dusky, sinus, blue, and the baby will suddenly go into shock. That means BP will be coming down. So such babies, you always suspect a congenital heart diseases. Usually they will be stable at the first 1 day, but usually deteriorates by day, second and third day. Such babies should be such a diagnosis should be considered, especially if the baby develop respiratory distress usually after 6 hours. And infection can be present within 6 hours or after 6 hours. And these rare diagnosis like a metabolic problems can present after 6 hours of life. This is how we'll diagnose based upon the gestational age. What are the common things? Based upon within 6 hours, which are the common things? So clubbing these two, any premature baby within 6 hours of distress, most common diagnosis will be an HMD. any term baby within 6 hours of life, the most common diagnosis will be TTNB, mucoid emancipation syndrome. These are the diagnoses. Hope I'm clear with these two slides. So very rarely the onset may be still more later. Suppose if the baby has a muscular problems, that means the baby is having a spinal cord problem or a neurological problems or a muscular problems, that can may manifest at a later age. And the babies with a heart disease, I told previously that a heart problem, any baby is having a heart problem may not present. If it is a severe zygotic heart disease, may present at a day one. But the majority of the duct, so most of you heard about duct dependent conditions. So such conditions will be deteriorated usually when the duct, patent ductus, that means ductus arteriosus closes. Usually that occurs by second and third day, that then there will be worsening, you can see. So these are based upon the age of onset and based upon the underlying causes. So if it, we can segregate the causes based upon if it is a lung issue. So these are the pulmonary causes. If it is a cardiac issue, it is a cardiac because of the cardiac problem. See, respiratory distress can occur because of the lung issue, because of the heart problem, because of the muscle, neuromuscular disorders, because of the metabolic problems, as well as the surgical problems. So why? Because it's respiration involves the muscular part, respiration involves the neurological part, respiration involves the lung, and respiration involves the heart. So that means gaseous exchange involves all these parts. So any problem anywhere will end up these conditions. So pulmonary causes, again, the same. The respiratory distress syndrome or the hyaline membrane disease or a meconium aspiration syndromes or a transient tachypnea of newborn. So I'm not explaining much of this because already I have explained the previous slides. And the cardiac problems, most common cardiac problems you will see is so cyanotic heart diseases usually present some from the day one or day two. Duct dependent conditions will present from day three or day four. Very rarely you can see a heart failures, and very, very, very rarely you can see a heart wall problems, that is cardiomyopathies. So regarding the neuromuscular diseases, sometimes you will not find any problem with the heart and lungs, but the babies will have an irregular deep breathing. That is because of the neuromuscular problem. That means the heart is okay, the lungs are okay, but the baby, if you see the baby breathing pattern, it is irregular. That is because of the CNS damage that has done because of sepsis or because of sepsis is infection, because of the sepsis or because of the asphyxia. Especially if you see the asphyxia babies, the lungs will be good. The heart might be a problem, or the brain at the brain may not send good signals to the lungs. So you will have an irregular breathing like that you will have. So asphyxiated babies can have this neuromuscular or neurological type of breathings. And the metabolic component, suppose a baby with an hypoglycemia, that means sugar is down, there can be light tachypnea to compensate that. And babies with a polycythemia, that means if the baby's hemoglobin, normally baby's newborn hemoglobin will be on a slightly higher side. Suppose if the hemoglobin is more, what happens is the blood vessel or the flow of the blood is slightly sluggish because viscosity of the blood will be more. So it can again leads to decreased oxygen supply, it can again leads to distress. So that condition is called as a polycythemic condition. Very rarely you can see, you come across the conditions like tracheoesophageal fistulas. That means there will be, this esophagus will not be full, it will be blind tract, and there will be fistula to the esophagus. That means connection to the esophagus to the trachea. So that is a surgical conditions which can present at birth from in newborn period. Congenital diaphragmatic hernia, that means the intestine bowels will perforate into the lungs because the diaphragm has small aperture or a small gap through it. The intestinal contents will go to the thorax and it can cause compression on the lungs. So there are many other conditions which can cause the respiratory distress in newborn. So based on these causes, so once you have to define the respiratory distress, and we should roughly get what is a preterm or term baby and what would be the underlying causes, which system is involved, that means lungs are involved, heart is involved, or neurological involvement is there, so that we can titrate accordingly. So next is, how are you going to approach the case? Now you know the case is a preterm baby or a term baby and there is a respiratory distress, and how are you going to approach this case? So first, from the history, whenever the case comes, so whatever you take is, you'll write a case sheet, you'll see the baby, and you'll ask for the risk factors. What are the risk factors for this baby? So from the maternal history, antenatal history, what are the risk factors? One is gestation. Absolutely, gestation is a risk factor. The more the premature babies, the more the hyaline membrane disease risk will be there. And antenatal steroid coverage. I would like to highlight this point, antenatal steroid coverage, because antenatal steroids has many beneficial advantages in addition to the lung maturity. Most of the, you know that steroid will help in increasing the lung maturity. Antenatal steroid, not for the baby, but the giving steroid, betamethasone or dexamethasone, giving to the mothers, especially for a premature birth, will improve the lung maturity. Not only the lung maturity will be improved because of this antenatal steroids, it also reduces the necrotizing enterocolitis, that means gut problems. It reduces the PDS, that means the cardiac problems. It reduces the IVS, that means intraventricular hemorrhages, that is brain problems. Not only the steroids will help in the baby's lung, but it also helps in different systems also. So antenatal steroids, always try to increase antenatal steroids in our unit. So then you need to ask about diabetes. So babies with diabetes will have a polycythemia and then can be having a distress. And pregnancy induced hypertension, that means maternal blood pressure is there. The babies will have decreased blood supply. So the babies will have growth restriction and it can cause a respiratory distress. And maternal asthma, maternal fever, which is a risk factor for the baby's infection. So polyhydramnios, oligohydramnios, whenever there's a polyhydramnios means increase in the amniotic fluid. So it is a precursor. If there is any baby is having a polyhydramnios, you need to rule out surgical conditions like the tracheoesophageal fistula needs to be ruled out. And oligohydramnios, that means the amniotic fluid is less, that in case the baby is having a in utero asphyxia, problems, growth failures. And coming to the intranatal events, that means delivery problems, you need to see PROM, that means prolonged rupture of membranes. That means any baby whose membranes are ruptured and amniotic fluid is leaked more than 18 hours, it's a risk factor for sepsis. That means infection for the babies. Chorioamnionitis, that means any baby with any maternal fever or any is foul smelling, that indicates the baby might get infection in the immediate period and can lead to pneumonias, congenital pneumonias. And meconium staining of Likert, very well everybody knows this meconium staining Likert. So maybe if you have meconium staining Likert, might have chance of meconium aspiration also. And babies with a fetal distress, any baby with a fetal distress in utero, there is a chance of passage of meconium, and that can lead to meconium aspiration syndrome. So C-section, that means cesarean section without delivery. Sometimes there will be no labor pains and there will be elective cesarean sections. Such babies will have more of delayed clearance of lung fluid. So that babies are more prone for transient tachypnea of newborn. So this is the approach we'll take about what are the risk factors so that we'll approach to our diagnosis. So other important clues is we need to ask for a prolonged or a difficult labor or assisted labor, fetal distress or meconium stained amniotic fluid. So all these are indicative of asphyxia or meconium stained Likert. If there's all these risk factors are there, so the baby's distress is because of asphyxia, that means neurological breathing, or it could be because of meconium aspiration syndrome. If the baby, if you do a PPV in a delivery room, suppose the baby didn't cry at birth, and if you do a positive pressure ventilation by means of AMBU bag, so there can be chance of pneumothorax if nurse is not trained or a doctor is not trained. So if you give more pressures with an AMBU bag, what happens is there can be the pneumothorax. That means the baby's lungs will rupture and they can cause a pneumothorax. That is called as an aid leaks. And if the baby's, I told you, amniotic fluid is more, there can be chances of tracheoesophageal fistulas. Amniotic fluid is less, oligohydramnios. Then, amniotic fluid is in turn related to the lung development. If there is sufficient amniotic fluid, the lung development will be good. Because in utero, what happens is the baby swallow amniotic fluid. So all the lungs are flooded with amniotic fluid. And this amniotic fluid, if it will have a growth factors, and it will be helping for the lung growth. But after birth, this should be cleared. Otherwise, it will lead to TTN. Then the next risk factors we need to see is maternal hypertension or preeclampsia. We can have an asphyxia or a mass component will be there. And if the baby is having a placenta previa or abruption, that means if there is a low-lying placenta or an abruption, that means if the placental cord is separated, then it leads to massive hemorrhage. So most of them you see before delivery, the mother is getting bleeding and there will be acute emergency. The baby is going into fetal distress. So we need to immediately do a surgery. Birth is what the gynecologist say. That is because of placenta previa or abruption, which can lead to birth asphyxia and the babies can go into shock. So and family history of unexplained neonatal death. So previous, if you are dealing with a case of Gravida 4 or Gravida 5, with previous four babies aborted or live births after birth, they gone death after 2 months or 3 months, compulsory you need to think that the baby might have a cardiac problem which is recurring, or it could be an inborn errors of metabolism. That means the baby is having a genetic issues. So you need to work upon it. And after feeding, if the baby is completely normal at birth and the post feed only the baby is deteriorating, we need to think that gastroesophageal reflex disease. That means GERD. That means a reflex that is coming coming from the stomach to the lungs. So any GERD is there, or if there is a cleft palate, if or cleft palate. Sometimes there not be cleft lip will not be there. If you see open the mouth and see, there will be cleft palate. So it leads to aspiration. So we need to treat it properly. And post feed deterioration, tracheoesophageal fistula, because there is a connection between the esophagus and the trachea. So it can lead to tracheoesophageal fistulas. And the interesting thing I would like to tell is any baby worsening, so baby will have a respiratory distress. And if there is baby's worsening, that means the cyanosis is worsening after crying. That indicates, suppose if the baby is having a respiratory distress and a baby is having some cyanosis, cyanosis means bluish discoloration. So note the interesting thing is if the baby after crying, the cyanosis is worsening, that means increasing, so it is cardiac condition. So if the baby after crying, if the cyanosis is improving, that means the baby is becoming better, that indicates there is a choanal atresia. Choanal atresia is nothing but choana is a posterior nostrils. So sometimes it is difficult to pass an NG tube. So most of them you have a habit of passing in a nasogastric tube at birth. Sometimes it may be not be passed because of this blockage here. So such conditions, if you, there will be cyanosis at birth if bilateral involvement is there. So if you stimulate and if you cry the baby's cyanosis will be relieved. That means it will improve. So that because the babies will take breathing with the mouth. So that is how this is an important point. Whenever the baby with a cyanosis with a respiratory distress worsening after crying, it's a congenital heart disease. If it is improving after crying, it's a choanal atresia. And any preterm babies after recovering will be going into prolonged oxygen deficiencies. Such conditions, the clue is by bronchopulmonary dysplasias or a CLDs. That is a chronic lung disease. So once you see from the approach from the history and the risk factors, we'll see what is the approach to the diagnosis based upon the clinical examination. Now we have asked the history, now we are going to the clinical examination. What are the points you need to see in the clinical examination? So one is a respiratory rate. So you need to count the respiratory rate. More than 60 is abnormal, tachypnea. So grunting I already told. So grunting is nothing but a protective mechanism to develop some pressure. So babies try to breathe with closed glottis, partially closed glottis, so that the end expiratory pressure will be maintained, so that the babies will have more amount of peep, so that the baby's alveoli will not collapse. So any grunting is there, retractions is there, that means the chest indrawing is there, bluish discoloration, cyanosis is there, chest inflation. What was the chest rise? With the breathing, is the chest is going good or not upward? So is there any air entry is good or not on both sides? Is there any cord is meconium stained or not? So see for the pulses, color, murmur. So you will auscultate it for the murmur, you will see for the pulses, and you will see for the pink or cyanosis. This is, and you can measure the blood pressure. And these are all the things which indicates the cardiac status, hemodynamic status. And for the signs of sepsis, we can see what are the signs of sepsis. Any baby with a fever in a newborn period is, most of the time it is sepsis. Or in a, now there's a maternal risk factor, you need to see the baby will be usually, peripheries will be very cool in a sepsis, at the center will be warm. That means you will call it as a tummy toe difference. That means tummy is stomach and toe is foot. So if there is a difference between the tummy toe, that indicates the baby is having a sepsis. And surgical conditions, always you need to rule out. Always pass an orogastric or a nasogastric tube so that we know that there is no tracheoesophageal fistulas. So then we need to see. So I say severity. Whenever the baby is having a respiratory distress, I say this baby is mildly severe. Suppose my colleague will say it's a moderately severe. Oh, no. Some other will come and say it is very much severe. How do you grade this severity? So we'll grade by two scores. One is a term baby scoring, other one is a preterm baby scoring. So for a term babies, what we'll use a score known as a Downey score. So for a preterm baby, what we'll use is a Silverman-Anderson score, right? So there should not be any confusion. So the components are different. For a Downey score, there will be the different component. So in a Downey score, there will be five component. So one is respiratory rate, the other one is cyanosis, the third one is grunting, the fourth one is retractions, and the fifth one is air entry. Air entry is one thing which we need to use a stethoscope. remaining all things is a visual assessment. Suppose if the respiratory rate is less than 60, the score is 0. That means not severe, normal. If the rate is between 60 to 70, score of 1. And more than 80, it is score of 2. So next is cyanosis. If the baby is breathing under room air and there's no blue color, no oxygen requirement, it is score 0. If the baby is breathing under room air, at less than 40% of oxygen or a prongs. So up to prongs also, you can you will use oxygen prongs. So for an oxygen delivery, you use your oxygen prongs or oxygen head box. So usually for a prongs, it is score 1. If there is no cyanosis with prongs. Suppose if there is a cyanosis even with the prongs and you need to move the head box or you started CPAP, which is requiring more than 40% oxygen, then it indicates the score of 2. So grunting, if there is no sound while breathing, it is none. So if there's only when you put a stethoscope and listen, then only you hear some grunting sound, score of 1. Without stethoscope also, you're hearing from a distant, we will see in the videos, then it is score of 2. And retractions, if there are no retractions, it is none. If it is mild, it is 1. Moderate to severe, it is 2. Air entry, you use a stethoscope. If the air entry is good on both sides, it is good. If it is decreased on both sides or one side, it is a score of 1. Very rarely it is audible, barely audible, that is score of 2. This is how you need to, you will score the term baby scoring. It is a Downey scoring. For a preterm babies, so preterm baby scoring, we I will talk in a later part, because in the case scenarios I will tell, because it is little difficult to understand. But here one thing you need to understand is the baby rate is not considered in a preterm, whatever the rate, because preterms are inherently having a higher rate than the term babies in distress. So rate is not considered here. So you'll see, what you will see is an upper chest retraction. That means anything above this mid axillary line. The next is geophoid retractions here, nasal flaring, the nasal flaring, and grunt. So there will be different scoring for both preterms and term babies. We'll score accordingly. So this scoring we'll see in the case scenarios separately. So how do you interpret this score? So you have done the scoring, and how do you know what to do for which score? So why? It is an indication for oxygen therapy. So 0, 1, 2, 3 is an indication for an oxygen therapy. And 4 to 6, we need to start CPAP. And more than 7, we need to consider a higher CPAP setting and more intubation settings. So we need to see if the baby is, even if the score is less than 3, we'll start oxygen, and we need to monitor every 1 hourly or every half an hourly, depending upon the sickness of the child, because score will not be constant. Suppose the score is 3 now. So with oxygen, the score may increase after 1 hour to score of 4. Then we need to see CPAP. So it's a continuous monitoring process. This score is a visual assessment. Suppose if you are a nurse and if you identify this score, that it is easy for the doctors to decide, even if they are not present at that time. Suppose the score of 3 now, after 1 hour, the score of 5, that indicates the baby is worsening. The score of 3 now, score of 5 now, and the score is now comes to 3, that indicates the score of baby is improving. That is how we will know the baby is improving or deteriorating. So this is a summary of whatever we talk in nutshell. In the history, we need to see the onset of the distress, when it is starting, what is the duration, is it in the less than 6 hours or more than 6 hours, or progress, how it is progressing, what are the risk factors like meconium, pH, diabetes, polycythemia, etc. Sensorium is very important. That means, is the child alert or dull? Dullness indicates the baby is having a severe problem. Asphyxiated babies can be dull. What was the color? If the baby color is not good, you might be dealing with a cardiac problem. So tone and cry, posture, that indicates the baby crying and tone and movements are good. If it is not good, you might be dealing with a severe respiratory distress or an asphyxia case. And we need to check for the vitals, heart rate, saturations, temperatures, etc. And perfusion, already I told, so you need to see the capillary refill time, heart rates, etc. And we need to assess the severity by either one score, preterm babies and preterm babies. So there are two types of therapies. One is general supportive therapy, which we'll usually do. So whenever any child or an adult patient comes, we'll stabilize with an airway breathing circulation like that. So there will be general management. So normally vital stabilization is ABC, that is airway breathing circulation. But in neonates, the dictum is TABC, that means temperature comes first above all. So we need to see with the warmth care is such an important thing. We need to see with the warmer temperatures. So temperature, airway, breathing, stabilization, circulation. So we need to stabilize that, whatever may be the cause. So we need to stabilize the temperature, use a radiant warmer, keeping the baby in the radiant warmer. So monitor the temperature. Airway is patent, you use the shoulder roll so that the airway will be patent. Breathing, you keep on oxygen or CPAP or a ventilator depending upon the severity. Circulation, you see if the fluid bolus or anything, cardiac dopamine or something, inotropes, whichever required. These are all the general management. Specific management based upon the cause. Suppose if you identify a pneumothorax, we need to put a needle and we need to drain it. Suppose you identify HMD as a cause, so you need to give a surfactant. Suppose if you have a cardiac problem, so you need to use a decongestion measures. You use a Lasix, the baby's in the failure, or you need to use an inotropic measures. So like that. So general measures is for the all. Specific measures, you need to identify the cause quickly because newborns will not give much time. So coming to the investigation part and the approach. So the first and foremost and the beautiful investigation is chest X-ray. Although nowadays ultrasound has been coming and replacing the chest X-ray, but the chest X-ray has its own beauty and its own charm. So chest X-ray still comes first. Do all babies require chest X-ray? Any baby with a respiratory distress in the newborn period, go with a chest X-ray without any hesitation, because you may be missing a very serious condition like a pneumothorax or tracheobronchial fistulas or a congenital diaphragmatic hernias, which are life-threatening. Unless you identify within chest X-ray, you do not know these conditions. So any baby with a respiratory distress in a newborn period, always get a chest X-ray done without any hesitation. So what are the other X-rays? Apart from the X-ray, we have an ultrasound examination and oxygen monitoring by pulse oximeters. Most of you know, might have known the pulse oximeters, because of this COVID has given an chance to learn most of us, because pulse oximeters are, you have a fingertip pulse oximeters, you have a monitor type of pulse oximeters. For babies, you will have a Masimo technology pulse oximeters and blood gases. That's an ABG, we call it an arterial blood gas. So what was the carbon dioxide level? What was the oxygenation levels? And then simple bloodside test. Previously we used to use one is shake test, which is used for the identification of surfactant deficiency in RDS, which we'll be learning in the next slide. And polymorph examination. That means you'll take some gastric aspirate, you put it in a microscope and you see if there is a polymorph, that means neutrophils, that indicates the baby might have upcoming sepsis, because the methadone chorioamnionitis, the amniotic fluid is flooded with inflammatory cells, that neutrophils, and that will be swallowed by the baby. And if you, after birth, if you give a stomach aspirate and you check in the microscope, then you will be identifying this condition. And we need to see sepsis screen. You need to do whenever necessary, whenever you suspect sepsis infection, you need to send a sepsis screen, which consists of CBC and a complete blood picture. And we have in CRP, microSR, etc. And blood culture is always gold standard for infections. Apart from this, for a cardiac cases, you need to go with an echo. For the neurological things, if you suspect any neurological things, because MRI is not bedside available, so you can go with neurosonogram. That means ultrasound of the brain, we call it as a neurosonogram. And IEM. So IEM is, so previously we have discussed any baby with a previous bad history, so baby dying after 10 days or 20 days without any reason. So in such cases, we need to send an IEM screen, which is called as a tandem mass spectroscopy, TMS screening, we will send. These are the general investigation. Not all babies require all investigation, but we need to prioritize based upon our symptoms. So this test previously we used to do. Nowadays we are not much doing, but still it has its own significant. So suppose, how do you know before X-ray, this baby lungs are mature enough or not? So after delivery of the baby, we will pass an OG tube, we'll take 0.5 ml of aspirate, and we can take 0.5 ml of absolute ethyl alcohol, that is 96% absolute ethyl alcohol, and both in the equal quantities, we will take it out, and we'll shake the in a test tube, and we'll shake it for 15 seconds, and we'll leave it aside for 15 minutes. Suppose after 15 minutes, if you doesn't see any layer like this, that indicate the baby's have no surfactant that indicate the baby doesn't have surfactant. So usually what happens is surfactant will have reduced surface tension. So it will be usually formed in the air liquid interface. So you will see bubbles here only. Like your soap is an excellent surfactant. It will have the detergent action. So like that, if you see this some bubbles here, so you need to see how much bubbles are there. If it is throughout the test tube like this, multiple rows and throughout the test tube, that indicates the lungs are mature. Suppose if you are seeing less rows, or if you are not seeing any of these throughout this circumference, if you are seeing only small bubbles here and there, that indicate that babies will have less surfactant and that might require a surfactant administration. Hope I am clear. I am not going into detail of this part because not nowadays we are doing much depending on the X-rays and the remaining other parameters with the advances. So I'll only concentrate on the X-ray part in this presentation because echoes and remaining I will not concentrate, but mostly I will go with an X-ray component. So X-ray most commonly will go with a diagnosis. Based upon the diagnosis, we'll see. So HMD. So HMD, I told, it's seen in the preterm babies. The respiratory distress will be seen within 6 hours of life. So there are three patterns. One is retinoglandular pattern. If at all, if you see a chest X-ray with a retinoglandular pattern, so you can see this kind of retinoglandular pattern. If you closely observe, I don't know how much it is visible to you. So if it is, if you see, there will be some granules like structures, some black things followed by white, small black things followed by white. So this is a mild to moderate hyaline membrane disease. That means some alveoli are getting collapsed, some alveoli are getting open. It means because it's a systemic problem. So whenever the lungs are affected, what happens is the smaller alveoli will have a more surface tension. So they close earlier than the larger alveoli. So in the initial phases of the disease, you can see this retinoglandular pattern. That means small black areas in between small white areas. That is the retinoglandular pattern, which is seen in the early phases of HMD. Okay.
Excuse
so the
moderate, me, sir.
Yeah.
Sorry to interrupt you, but I'm scared we might run out of time. So I request you to please finish everything in next 20 minutes.
Yeah, sure. Right.
So
this is how an X-ray will be seen in HMD cases. So this is mild cases. In a moderate to severe cases, what happens is this bigger alveoli will also be collapsed. So entire lung become white out lung. So that severe form is a white out lung. So you can appreciate in this X-ray, you can see the partially granular pattern, which is a retinoglandular pattern. And in the next X-ray, which is more severe, so this is a complete white out lung. So this is more total white out lung, so which require different surfactant therapies. This is how you will identify an HMD X-ray. So in case of TTNV, that means delayed clearance of water. So what happened is two important features here is, I will not confuse you much. So most of the time there will be starry appearance. That means, so if you see the heart border, if you see the starry pulmonary vasculature like this, like a sunburst type, it will be like radiating like this. That is an important one of the important feature of TTNV, because the pulmonary vasculature is contains of more amount of this absorbed water. So this will be prominent. And the most important thing which will identify TTNV is because of this horizontal fissure. So if you see the lobes of the lungs on the right lung, so if you see between the upper lobe and this middle lobe, you will have an interlobar fissure. And this fissure is prominent. This white line you see, if you see any X-ray with this white line, that indicates the baby is having a TTNV component. That is a transient tachypnea of newborn. And the next X-ray is meconium aspiration syndrome. This X-ray is, you can call it as a dirty picture. Like, so this X-ray, this is all flooded with all this meconium starry, all these meconium, and it is going to eat away the lungs like anything. That means it causes inflammation. So this bilateral diffuse non-homogeneous opacities, whenever you see, that indicates it's okay. With the meconium stain like it, most of the time it indicates meconium aspiration syndrome. So this is another X-ray with the meconium aspiration syndrome. You can see these are diffuse opacities on both sides. So child with a pneumonia, this is clear cut. We can identify there will be a patchy type of appearance. You can see all these are black lungs. Suddenly you will see homogeneous or non-homogeneous. Most of the time it can be homogeneous, and you can see a patchy type appearance. So it's a right lower zone consolidation, which is called a right lower zone pneumonias. So this is how you are identifying X-ray. And most importantly, if you do an AMBU very within high pressures, or if the baby's lungs are weak, so it might lead into pneumothorax. So such pneumothorax we'll see like this. If you see this lung X-ray, so what is happening here? The lung is like this. The opposite lung has been ruptured and it caused pneumothorax. How do you identify? The lungs will be hyperinflated. If you see this lung, the left lung is going beyond the right lung, and you will see all the darkishness to each other. That is hyperlucency. Because of the age, these lungs will be much more darker. And you can see there is a mediastinal shift. That means it is pushing the heart to the opposite side. So this X-ray is a characteristic of a pneumothorax. So clinically, how do you identify before X-ray? Sometimes X-ray may be late and you are suspecting. How do you identify pneumothorax? Suppose if there is the saturations are coming down and the air entry is very less on the left side, you will do what is the test called as a transillumination test. So you will put a transilluminator. That means you can put a red torch like thing and you can see the glow here also. That indicates it is completely surrounded by the air. So we need to do a needle dryness, or if you get a X-ray, it will confirm like this. So which is pneumothorax, and we need to drain it. Otherwise the baby will not improve. So the next condition, can you identify this condition? In this condition, what is happening is the abdomen is empty. There is no gas in the abdomen. So whatever the bowel that is there is going into the chest. So you can see the bowel loops. These are all the bowel loops. That means the stomach, intestine, everything is going up. So this is called as a congenital diaphragmatic hernia. Suppose any baby who is worse, this baby should not be done bag and mask. So any baby who is worsening on bag and mask and the abdomen is little sunken, and you can hear an intestinal peristaltic movements in the chest, and chest X-ray is showing and multiple bowel loops in the chest, that indicates you are dealing with a congenital diaphragmatic hernia and you need a pediatric surgeon to operate this case. So this is the general investigations. Chest X-ray is the basic investigations. So regarding the treatment, I will not go much because we are running out of the time. So basic management, I told basic management, you need to stabilize the baby, temperature, oxygen, CPAP if needed, ventilation if needed, and circulatory support with an inotropes, fluid boluses, etc. So we need to correct. In addition, we need to take care of hypoglycemia, which is very important. So if you don't correct the hypoglycemia, how much you ventilate the baby, there is no use. So you need to correct the polycythemia if the blood viscosity is high. So you need to take out some blood. That means a partial exchange transfusion we do. If the baby, there is a signs of sepsis, we need to add antibiotics. So if required, you go with a CPAP and ventilation. Based upon the severity, we'll do. So oxygen, always you target saturations between 90 to 95. So most of them will be targeting 100% saturation. That is not required for the babies. So 90 to 95 saturation is okay for a term baby or a preterm babies. Because higher oxygen saturations will lead to ROP, retinopathy of prematurity, and bronchopulmonary dysplasia, that is BPD lungs. So it is difficult problem for the babies in a chronic state. So always target your oxygen level so that your saturation in the pulse oximeter is 90 to 95 sufficient. Suppose if the baby is less than 90 saturation, it can lead to more amount of mortality. So always try to maintain this saturation limits. So these are the different methods. I will not go into the deep. So you know, so one is a low flow, from the basic to the highest. Low flow nasal cannulas, you will be putting some prongs, nasal prongs into the nostrils. Then there will be head box, we'll keep an head box over the head, and you will have an HFNC, that is before CPAP, we are having a high flow heated humidified nasal oxygen you can give, or CPAP. So most of them who don't know CPAP, I think most of you know. If anyone doesn't know CPAP, no need to worry, because CPAP session will be conducted in detail by Dr. Kirithi in the coming sessions. So you will be learning more about CPAP in that sessions. So if there is mechanical ventilation, then this is from the least to the highest severity of support. So investigations, apart from the chest X-ray, most important, you will use a pulse oximeter to titrate the oxygen levels. And sometimes we need to go with an ABC, because your carbon dioxide, so oxygenation, we'll get a rough idea with a pulse oximeter, but carbon dioxide, we don't know how much it is going on. So in between, we need to do an arterial blood gas. That means you need to take out some blood from the artery and you need to see what was the carbon dioxide levels. So specific management. So if it is in addition to the general management, we need to go with the specific management, unless otherwise it will not improve. Suppose if the diagnosis is HMD, like a white out lung, we need to give a surfactant. If there is an air leak like a pneumothorax, what we told you, we will drain it with a new intercostal dryness tube or a needle aspiration. If it is a polycythemia, that means blood is more, we need to do a partial exchange transfusion. That means you need to take out blood and you need to give NS. If it is anemia because shock anemia, then we need to give Packard RBC transfusion. If there is a congestive heart failure, then you need to treat it with inotropes, diuretics, and digoxin like the adults. And if it is duct-dependent condition, I told third day, second day, if the baby duct closes and it is... So normally, ductus arteriosus will be open, third day it will close. Most of the babies will not have effect, but some heart condition will depend upon ducts. So we need to maintain that duct until it is operated. So such conditions, we use what drug called as prostaglandins, which will help in opening or maintaining the patency of the duct. And for the tracheoesophageal esophageal fistulas, we need to go with the surgeries. CDH, there's a congenital diaphragmatic hernia, we'll go with surgery. So TEF is relatively emergency, whereas diaphragmatic hernias, cleft palate, and all these are relatively, we need to stabilize the baby and we need to do the surgery. So most of them think that CDH is an emergency. No, CDH is an emergency, but not emergency for the surgery, emergency for the respiratory support. Right? And very rarely, even after ventilator also, the babies might not improve. Their lungs are so much immature, or so much meconium will be flattened, there will not be any gastric success. In such condition, we'll go with high frequency ventilation, the next modes, inhaled nitric oxide and ECMOs. So there's a higher version where when the babies are deteriorating, then we'll go with such method. So this is the end of the normal approach to respiratory distress. So I was asked to talk about the apnea of prematurity. So apnea of prematurity, I will cover a little briefly. Apnea is nothing but, so sometimes this most common in premature babies. So most of you will be sitting in a premature babies. So what happens is sometimes you'll be seeing in your ICUs, the babies will be suddenly stopping breathing and their saturation will fall down, heart rate will fall down. That is nothing but because of the immaturity of the brain, the signals are not coming. So such condition is called as an apnea of prematurity. Less than 34 weeks, you see most of this condition. So how do you define is there will not be any breathing movement or an airflow movement for more than 20 seconds. If there is baby stops breathing for more than 20 seconds and is associated plus or minus associated with a low heart rate, 100, less than 100, we call it as an apnea of prematurity. That means baby breathing stoppage is called an apnea of prematurity. The different types of apneas, it is central apneas, peripheral apneas, obstructive apneas, and mixed apneas. Central means brain is immature, so that signals are not coming, so that the brain is not giving signals, so the breathing will be stopping. Whereas in case of obstructive apneas, the brain is ready to give signal, but because of secretions, because of this all secretions, there will be pooling of secretions here in the chest, so that it blocks the airways and it can lead to obstructive apneas. Sometimes there can be a mixed apneas, that means there can be central driving will be less, and there will be pooling of secretions. These are all the mixed apneas. These are the three types of apneas. And if you see the pathophysiology, it's because of mainly because of the immaturity of the CNS predominantly. And I'm not going into the details of this pathophysiology. So apart from the apnea of prematurity, we have other causes of apnea, like secondary apnea. Suppose the babies have an infection, the babies can stop breathing. So we need to rule out sepsis. Suppose the baby is having an polycythemia, that means more amount of blood. So they can stop breathing. So these are multiple reasons for apneas, that means stoppage of breathing, of which we need to exclude all these conditions in the slide so that we can call it an apnea of prematurity. That means apnea of prematurity should be labeled once you rule out the secondary apneas. That means you rule out the infections, you rule out the hypothermia, hypoglycemia, polycythemia, everything you rule out. Then if there is an apnea, a premature baby, we call it as an apnea of prematurity. Or sometimes there can be an intraventricular bleeds in the brain, so which can lead to stoppage of breathing. Then it can lead to IVH. That can also can cause apneas. So general measures, normally whenever the baby stops breathing, what we'll try to do is, we'll stimulate the baby. That is one technique. If it is revived, it's okay. If it is not revived, then we need to keep a CPAP. There is multiple apneas, we will go with the next level CPAP machine. There is a multiple levels, we will keep a ventilator in a nasal ventilation, that is non-invasive ventilation. Suppose if the baby is not improving, suppose if after stimulation the baby is stopping apneas, again it is coming. In a premature babies, especially less than 1250 grams, you can go with capnea, that is caffeine citrate. So caffeine citrate is nothing but, it's a respiratory stimulant. So the loading dose will be 20 mg per kg. That comes as 1 ml per kg per kg of the baby birth weight. Suppose 2 kg baby, it will be 2 kg like that, it will be there. And sorry, 2 ml. And the maintenance will be 1/4 of the loading dose. 0.5 will be your maintenance for the these babies. So what happens is this increases the diaphragmatic motility, so it decreases the apnea. So whenever you have a premature baby with a respiratory apnea problems, you go with caffeine. You can start caffeine. So if you don't have a caffeine, you can give aminophylline also. So in a government hospital, if there is no caffeine, you can go with aminophylline also. Usually, how long we need to continue this apnea for a premature babies, for a 1250 gram babies, until they complete 34 to 36 weeks of gestation. Okay, so they should be completing around 34 to 36 of gestation, and there should not be apnea for 7 days. That much period we can give apnea for the babies. So from the CVRT low side, we'll stimulate, we'll start apnea. Again, there is apnea coming, you can stimulate, continue apnea. But recurrent apneas are coming, then we need to go with either CPAP machine, because CPAP will open the airways, sprint the airways. Still apneas come, you go with non-invasive ventilation. Still apnea comes, we go with invasive ventilation. That is how we'll treat the apnea. Hope I am a little faster with the apnea, with apnea and apnea, but I think I have teach the point. So we'll go with the case scenarios. Such as case.